firm all the way to the end of their life. And it was conversion. True conversion. And that's what the church needs today. In which in times past you were not a people, but you are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now you have obtained mercy. Dearly beloved, what's this word? What's another word for that we know? Beg. I beg you. What is Peter begging? I beg you as strangers and pilgrims. Strangers and pilgrims of what? Of this world. You understand? This is not your home. This is not your world. If your life is caught up here, if you want to keep up with the Kardashians, that's all the reward you will have. Right?
Right,
jumps in the hole, right? That's right. Now think about this. Millions and millions, if not billions, are willing to sacrifice their eternal life for 60 years, 70 years, 80 years of the best this world has to offer. Let me ask you, ladies, those of you who have ripened with maturity,
raise your hands, please.
Listen, you go back and you look at the pictures of what you looked like when you were in your 20s. Look in the mirror today. Joyce, is there a difference? Let me tell you something. How long does that beauty last?
Ooh.
The Bible says beauty is fleeting, right? Now, men, question's coming to you now. Okay? Those of you, Ray?
Yeah.
Did you always have that much hair on your head?
There was a time I had a few more morning.
Okay? Bob? Yeah. You play golf anymore?
I beg your pardon?
Do you play golf anymore?
No more.
Why?
Too old.
Guys, what you used to be able to do, now you can't do. There comes a point when you used to be able to do all things. Then there came that point in time when I can't do what I used to do, but I can still do it once. Then there comes a time where you can't even do that at all. Right? Can't play golf. Sometimes you can't even walk out the door. Right? Isn't that what happens with age? Beauty. What is true beauty? If it's only what's on the outside that lasts maybe 30 years and then it goes away, it is what is inside. And this is for men and women. It is the beauty of a character that has walked with God faithfully and has known Him and has grown mature in that walk with God. Would you rather be with Mrs. Kardashian and have her as a friend, or a Christian who in their maturity with God, you know, has your back in good and bad? Would you rather continue to have that relationship with your spouse who you promised to love and cherish and honor for richer, for poorer, sickness and in health, till death do you part? Or would you only stay with a person as long as they're pretty? Okay? And when they don't become pretty no more, you find somebody else who is pretty. And then they get rid of you because you're no longer pretty.
We used to always say, well, she has a good personality.
So listen. That is the difference between the darkness of this world and the light that God has now called you into. This character that Jesus will create in you, that He makes in you, that is a mirror image of Himself, right? And that the longer you walk with Him, the clearer that image becomes. I would rather be around those people than the richest people in this world. Riches don't last, right? Bill Gates, when he dies, what's going to happen to all that money he's got?
Family will fight over it.
The cockroaches will come out. You know the cockroaches, because every family's got them. When you die, they come out. You haven't heard from them in a long time, but when you die, there they are. Looking at the crumbs, hoping to get something. Solomon said all of that was a striving for the wind. It was what?
Vanity.
Vanity. Right? Vanity. But those who put their trust in the Lord will never be put to shame. Okay, so that's the time saying you better wrap this up. Dearly beloved, I beg you, as strangers and pilgrims, you are not of this world, but you have an inheritance that is incorruptible. You have a reward that can never be taken away from you. And what God has put, God will give, and God will keep safe until that day. And if you trust in Him, and you are strangers and pilgrims, abstain from what? Fleshly lust, which war against the soul or the spirit. That is the difference between walking in the flesh and walking in the spirit. That's the difference between having victory and being defeated. Are you walking in the spirit or are you walking in the flesh? Do you have your trust fully in Christ, or do you still captain your own ship? Mm-hmm. Who's on the throne of your heart? The problem is Jesus can be on my heart, throne of my heart now, and 5 minutes from now, that may not be the case. Right? Yeah. That's humanity. This is why it is a continual submission to His will. Okay, so as we close, having your conversation honest amongst the Gentiles, who has a New King James Version? Can you read that verse, verse 11? No, verse 12.
First Peter.
First Peter. There's something different. There's a different word than conversation. I can't remember what it is. I had it in here.
Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles.
So, instead of, it's not just your conversation, but it is your conduct. It's a much deeper meaning for that word. Having your conduct honest amongst the Gentiles, that word, can you read that? No, I mean from your book.
Okay.
Okay.
What
did
they speak?
Read the whole verse of verse 12.
12?
Yes.
Okay. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation.
Now, I want you to see the difference between what Peter was writing to and his people were enduring and what we endure today. So what do you think of as when they speak against you as evildoers? In your day, how does that fit our lives? The here and the now. Who? Who's going to accuse you?
We're called fanatics.
Okay. I've been called that.
Legalists.
I've been called that too. So, but who called you that?
People that don't believe you know.
Okay.
Other Christians.
But it's somebody you know, right? Because strangers ain't going to call that to you because they don't know you, right? So mainly it's going to be like your neighbors. Right? Gossiping. Right? Maybe even church members. The big one that we deal with is our families. Right? How many of you are the only Adventists in your family? Look around. Keep your hands up. Look around. There's a lot of us. Right? I have been called all that stuff. Okay? But in the end, when they have a question about the Bible, who do they come to?
You.
You know what I'm saying? Why is that? Because we're such legalists. We know the Word of God. In Peter's day, these people, these Gentiles, were actually going to the authorities, and the ones they were speaking evil against were being arrested, losing their houses, maybe even losing their lives. So what was his counsel to them? He says, I beg you to abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honest among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, why? Because you do not burn incense to Caesar. You don't go to the market and take all those things that have been offered to idols. You don't go to the Friday and Saturday night parties anymore. You know what I'm saying? You're just wicked. Go figure. But when they call you these things, they may by your good what?
Works.
Which they shall see, because that's what your conduct is. That's who you are. Not this is how I act. Now listen, how many of you guys are in business? Raise your hand. Business. As a businessman, you can act a certain way and that may not be who you are at all. Is that right? You realize there's no difference between you and a church person? We come to church. What I put on here may not be who I am the other 6 days. Right? Got a good point?
Yeah.
A business person. A business person, a politician, and a church person. Do you want the true or the false? Can you tell the true and the false between a politician? It's hard, but understand this. Spirit of prophecy tells us this. The Word of God tells us this as well. God sets up governments for His purpose. Okay? God has His people in governments, the Spirit of prophecy tells us. And they'll be there all the way until Jesus comes. You as a voter have the privilege but also the obligation to vote according to your conscience. That way, if it turns out badly and your guy doesn't get in there, you can complain.
Right.
If it turns out badly and you didn't vote, don't want to hear it. If you voted for the person that did the bad things, hopefully you'll learn the next time. Okay? That's the politician. The business person. You usually find out where their character is after you do a certain amount of business with them, and you realize whether they're cheating you or whether they're honest, whether they stand behind their product or whether they do good work. Is that right? Whether their word is true. So it's not hard with a business person to see after a certain period of time where they stand. I'd rather deal with a politician than a deceitful church person. Because a church person can hide their stuff for a long period of time, right? Understand, this is how the world sees us. The question is what kind of church person are you? Are you the political church person? Are you the business church person? Or are you a follower of Jesus Christ? Okay, we'll close. Our closing hymn this morning will be hymn number 518. Tom, can we go up and put this?